pray. Father, normally when we use that term, that we're overwhelmed, it's because we're overwhelmed by problems, we're overwhelmed by frustration, we're overwhelmed by circumstances and events, we're overwhelmed by emotions that tend to take us to places that we don't want to go. But Father, the words of this song give us the flip side. When we're overwhelmed with you, then problems and circumstances cannot capsize our life. When we are overwhelmed with you, there are no situations in this world that can destroy us. For Father, it is your strength, it is your power, it is your influence, it is your presence, it is your sufficiency. And so, Father, I pray that if any of us arrived here today underwhelmed with you, that we will leave here overwhelmed by you. That is our prayer this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Welcome to New Hope Community Church. It is great to have you with us today. Thanks for being here. If you are a guest, it's your first time here, we are honored that you would choose New Hope as your place of worship today. There are some cards, communication cards in the pew. I'd love for you to take one. Fill it out if you would, please. Drop it in the offering bag. We'll do our best not to annoy you this week, but through the mail, send you some information that we hope will be very, very helpful for you. So, welcome. For those of you who are regulars and we missed you last week, good to have you back. All right, good to have you back. I'm going to make a little announcement I don't often make around here. If you missed last week, I would love for you this week to go to the website and listen to last Sunday's sermon. I don't ask that often, all right? But the reason is last Sunday is the foundation for the rest of the year. Okay? Doesn't mean if you didn't hear last Sunday's that you'll miss out every Sunday and so then you'll just stay home for the rest of the year. It's not what I'm saying, but last week was a pretty strong foundation for why we're going to be in the book of Psalm for the year 2016. We can't preach every chapter. There's 150 chapters in the book of Psalms. We've only got 52 Sundays. But we're going to be highlighting key chapters, starting today with Psalm chapter 1. But I'll give just a brief review today. But last Sunday was a pretty strong foundation that we wanted to lay for where we're going. So I would love it if you would take the opportunity to do that. Let me highlight a few announcements. Actually, it's more than just a few. This is going to be a little longer family time than most Sundays, all right? Beginning of a year, lots of stuff going on. Lots of departments got things happening they wanted highlighted. So we're going to take a big, deep breath, all right? You comfortable? Weather's good, about right, not too hot, not too cold. We're doing okay? All right. So let's jump in here. Tonight, things kick off tonight, 6 o'clock. The leaders of our Hope Group, Teddy and Corey, all right, have planned a special evening, and they want all of our Hope Group participants to come and join us tonight. If you have been in a small group at New Hope this past year, they would love for you to come tonight. It's a night of worship and testimony about how God has worked through your small group in your life this past year, whether it was a project that you did, whether it's a Bible study you participated in, a special need in your life, and your small group rallied around you. We want to hear those testimonies. There will also be some people coming tonight who are not in a small group, but they want to know more about what's this thing Pastor always talks about. He tries to guilt us and join in a small group, all right? Guilt doesn't work. I don't want you to do it by guilt. I want you to see the benefits of small group. They're not perfect, okay? Small, you know why they're not perfect? Because we're members of a small group, okay? But man, the benefits, I'm convinced. It's they met from house to house, the New Testament church, started small groups. And so I think they're of great benefit. So come out tonight. It's not going to be a long service. I think probably 6 to 7 o'clock. And there is some refreshments. And since there's going to be refreshments, we would kind of like an idea how many are going to come back tonight. Not a long service. Football game probably just about over. Nobody's playing worth anything anyway, so it's okay. The ones who had value played last night, right, Jennifer? They won. All right. So, if you're going to come back tonight, you think you're going to come back tonight, all right, from 6 to 7, raise your hand real quick. Keep it up for a moment. You're going to come back tonight. Okay. What, this side is more spiritual than this side? Everybody, nobody's... Okay. All right. So we got one. Keep them up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Okay. About 25. We had 14 in the last service. So we're going to probably say around 75 to 85 would probably show up tonight. All right. Here's a deal, guys. There's over 200 in small groups. Maybe you ought to pray about that this afternoon and come show up tonight, all right? Moving on now. Men's Tuesday night Bible study that Gene teaches is going to be kicking off this Tuesday night, all right? Picking up where you finished right before Christmas. So you're going to be starting this Tuesday night. You'll be back in the bridge, all right? Back in your old home place. So that's this Tuesday night. Thursday morning men's group started last Thursday morning, all right? It was our introduction to the new study that we are going to be doing this year called The Fight. Winning the battles that matter most. They were a day late getting here. So guys, we had 24 men show up Thursday morning. It was good, all right? So the books are in. If you were here last Thursday, come on up, pick up your book. You can pay for them next Thursday, all right? But you can pick them up today. If you think you're going to be in the group, pick one up. Take it with you. We'll take care of that during our Thursday morning Bible studies, okay? Next, there's several things going on in the women's calendar, all right? Tuesday night women's Bible study, Wednesday morning women's Bible study, a new Bible study starting on a Saturday morning. So all that's in here. So ladies, and their sign-up sheets for the Tuesday night because of material. I guess if you're going to be going to Wednesday, you should sign up too so you have material. Okay, all right. So, and also one other thing on the sign-up sheet, Wednesday night starting January the 13th, which is this coming Wednesday night. Happens to be my sister's birthday. You can wish her a happy 66th birthday if you would like, okay? That's this Wednesday. I won't do that in the next service. But starting January 13th and going through February the 24th, our kids are going to be studying Kings and Queens of the Bible. But on that same hour, from 7 to 8 o'clock on Wednesday night, the parents and grandparents have a chance to study Raising Kingdom Kids. It's a parenting class. The material is written by Tony Evans, one of my favorite pastors out of Texas. And Corey Gallardo is going to be directing and facilitating that study. And you can sign up for that also on the sign-up board. All right, one I'm going to spend a couple of minutes on now, Sunday school teachers. This is a church of over 800 active people. Okay? We have between 550 and 6 and a quarter just about every single Sunday. 9:15 and 10:45, we have 6 classes for our children. They're our future. There has been an ad in here for 4 months. It's still there. I don't want to guilt anybody into teaching a Sunday school class, but I would like to challenge you. Do you remember last Sunday a question I asked during the sermon? I asked you to look back over the past year and ask yourself the question, when was I engaged in ministry? Ministry is not just the job of the professionals, quote. God calls every single one of us into ministry. There's all kinds of ways to do ministry. One of the ways that I still strongly believe is important and essential, Sunday school. I can tell you, apart from my own family, the two most influential people in my life were Helen Bronstein and Martha Wiley. Helen Bronstein was my Sunday school teacher from first through third grade, and Martha Wiley was my Sunday school teacher from fourth through sixth grade. They didn't teach 1 month on and 1 month off, which is what we do here. People need a break. Those women taught 3 years, 52 Sundays out of a year, maybe took off two for vacation. Why? Because they saw the value of pouring into the lives of boys and girls at a young age, truth of the Scripture. Helen Bronstein had only been saved 6 months when she started teaching Sunday school. We have material that is easy to follow. We have material that is Christ-centered. It doesn't take a lot of prep, but the more prep, the better it is. I'm asking you, Tim, I've done my dues. Really? Really? Are you dead yet? Tim, I'm too old. How old was Caleb when he conquered the mountain in the promised land? He was past 80. And do you know what he said? I am as strong today as I was the first time I laid eyes on it. I can go, and by God's strength, I can conquer it. How old was Moses when he led the children of Israel to the promised land? He was 80. You're not too old. You're not too young. Some of these kids need a grandparent, godly figure in their life. They don't have anybody with snow on the mountaintop who hugs them and says, God loves you. I want to pray for you. They need that. So they say, Tim, I'm too young. Really? My sister started teaching a Sunday school class when she was 14 years old. That was 100 years ago. Tim, that's a woman's job. No, it isn't, men. Those kids need a godly figure in their life. We got two men right now, Bill Eccles and Mark Addis, teach. Okay? They teach. Well, Tim, I can't go to worship if I teach. Oh, Cam, we have three worship services. You teach one session, you work. Oh, Tim, that's shorter than a football game. That's shorter than a day at the spa. What I'm asking is for you guys to say in 2016, God, how do you want to use me in ministry? Because I believe that some of you he wants to use over there. Tim, I teach all week long. Great, you'd be perfect for the classroom. Perfect for it. Pray about it. Okay, anybody mad yet? Senior luncheon, Tuesday, first one of the year, Tuesday, senior luncheon. Some of you qualify if you're 55 or older. All right, you're welcome at the senior luncheon. Hey, less than 3 weeks, five of us from New Hope Church are joining about 65 others from around the United States heading to the Ivory Coast of Africa. That time is here. We leave on the 31st, okay? So one, be sure to be praying for us. Steve Childress from our church was asked to do an extra project just about 2 weeks ago, all right? We're taking the 21st century to the Ivory Coast. All right? Medical supplies are not cataloged. We often don't know what we have till we get there, and so we duplicate stuff. So because Steve is an IT guy at the Veterans Hospital here in Fresno, he's been asked to bring that same kind of quality inventory control to our medical supplies there. And so there's some software that needs to be purchased to make that happen. A little bit of hardware to go along with it. So it's a last minute thing. It's about $2,500. He shared it in men's group on Thursday. And I know some guys are going to give. If you want to be a part of that, just make a check or put cash in an envelope for new, if it's a check, to New Hope Church. But on the envelope, write IT Project Ivory Coast. All right. And we'll see that that gets taken care of. February the 21st. If you are 40 or younger, listen up, okay, 40 or younger. If you happen to be married to somebody who is 40 and younger, but you have exceeded that age, you're included too, Mark Addis. Okay, February the 21st. We actually wanted to do this 2 weeks from tonight, and I discovered that that is the NFL and AFL playoff championship games. And I figured the chance of getting the guys at that age group to come would probably be very minimal. But that night, put that calendar, it's a Sunday evening, we're going to have a one-hour event here at the church. We want everybody who's 40 and younger to come join us. We're going to have some food here, okay? We're going to have a special guest here, but we really want to talk to you. So this is kind of 25 to 40. We want to talk to you about vision, okay, for ministering to your age group in the year 2016 through New Hope Church. So we want husbands and wives, we want parents, whether you're single, whether you're married, we want you here, all right? We'd love to have you here. So put that on your calendar. You'll be getting an invitation from us very soon. There is a insert in your bulletin. We talked about this last week in last Sunday's sermon, okay? Starting tomorrow. So some of you, you weren't here, you didn't know about this, catch me off guard, starts tomorrow. There's going to be about 100 churches in the cities of Fresno and Clovis that are going to be sharing in this, okay? We've got about 40 out of our 8 o'clock service that said, yep, Tim, I'm going to do this with you. 21 days together as churches in our cities, praying and fasting for renewal in the church and revival in our cities. And anytime you use the word fasting, people get nervous. I got to be honest, when people say the word fast, I get nervous. Okay? So that's why I prepared this, okay, along with some other pastors, because I wanted to give some explanation. You see, in the Bible days, the thing that they spent more time doing besides work, the thing they spent most of their time doing was preparing food and eating food. They didn't have social media, they didn't have television, they didn't have radio. And so when they wanted to devote more time in prayer, they took away one of those things that consumed so much of their time. And the time they spent in preparation and in the process of eating was now committed to prayer. As I said last week, if you're a diabetic, please don't go on a fast, okay? In fact, if you're a diabetic, maybe take the next 21 days to eat the way you should eat, okay, rather than the way that you do eat. So what I would like to suggest is commit to 21 days of extended prayer for these two things. Choose something that you will fast from. And don't tell anybody, because Jesus said, hey, wash your face, comb your hair, don't tell anybody you're fasting. Okay, except, I am going to tell your family. Okay, because if you're not going to be eating certain things, you probably ought to tell whoever prepares so that they don't put your favorite thing out there, all right? Makes a big temptation. But let them know, because that's for the purpose of some accountability in your life through this. Some examples that I gave you on here, hey, maybe you're going to fast from television. Here's a good one for the next 21 days. You are going to fast from football games. Sacrifice, huh? Maybe you're going to fast, okay, from social media. I've been on social media more since Wednesday than I have in my entire life, okay? For those of you who do not know yet, I am now a grandfather, okay? I am now a grandfather. There is Bo rolling, all right? Bo Jordan, isn't that so cute? He was sending Grandpa a kiss right there. He was 8 pounds, 5.5 ounces, 21 and a half inches long, and everybody's home, 17 hours of labor. It's a better picture back there if you turn and look back there. It's not quite so washed out. Oh. And I'm going Tuesday to get to see him, and the rest of us will go a little later in the year. Anyway, so it's been a good week for a whole lot of reasons. So figure out a way to pray and fast. So here's the deal. Those of you here last week, you had a week to pray about this. Am I going to get engaged in this for the next 21 days? It ends at an event at Fresno Pacific University. You don't have to attend the event to participate in this, but it's designed for us to come together as communities. Unfortunately, Mark and I will not be able to be there because we will be in Africa when this event takes place, but somebody from our church will kind of be the point person. It ends at Fresno Pacific College with a special evening of worship that night. So if you think that you are going to take the 21-day challenge to spend some extended time in prayer, starting the 11th and ending on the 22nd, would you raise your hand? Just yeah, Tim, I'm going to do this, okay? Keep up for just a moment, because I... Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. We're just supposed to let folks know about how many from our church are going to be engaged. Thank you for doing that. Okay, one correction in the bulletin, and then we'll do prayer requests. We did not receive, in the month of November, $808,871.77. Just kind of in case you read that, I want to let you know that would have been a really good month, okay? That would have been a really, really good month. That is close to being accurate for the entire year, all right? For the whole year of 2015, that is just about what we did, all right? A few issues, it's getting corrected. There was some 2015 that got included in 20. Remember that little complicated thing I told you last week? Well, it happened, all right? So it's getting sorted out, but that's very close, within about $1,500 one way or the other. Here's some prayer requests. Tim Kepler is not with us. He's been in India and Japan the last 2 months, so that's why he's not been with us in November and December. He was supposed to be here today, but Tim had knee surgery on Friday. He will be with us next Sunday. So he has not quit us. He's not left us. He'll just be back next Sunday. This afternoon at Garfield Elementary School is the service for the 9-year-old young man I shared with you last Sunday was killed in an ATV accident, the Rossini family. Those services were earlier in the week up in Oakdale, and there's going to be a celebration of life at Garfield Elementary this afternoon. Dylan Little had surgery on Friday, and so be praying for his recovery. He had an infection. Joe Wilhite, my neighbor, former rodeo grand marshal here in Clovis. Her parents started the pack station up at Huntington Lake. She fell and broke her hip this week, and would appreciate your prayers. Chuck McClellan was 97. We did his service yesterday. He is the great-great-great-great-great-grandson of General McClellan, who fought in the Civil War, and add about two more greats, and his great-grandfather was the Brigadier General in the Revolutionary War. Yeah, that's pretty impressive. Ethel Vrindenberg is a service tomorrow. It's connected to the Angelich family, so please remember them. And then a couple of requests that I've just been handed this morning. There's a family that had twins, a girl Peyton and a baby boy Wyatt, and they were born 3 months early. So premature, just both of them a little over a pound? 2 pounds, right at 2 pounds, okay? So please be praying for them and their continued growth and health. And Julie Hammock's mom is in ICU, some issues as a result of a fall. So they would appreciate you remembering to pray for them. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our tithes and offerings today. Guys, would you come? As you pray, remember to pray for those maybe just sitting around you, even if you don't know their name, all right? You have no idea the kind of challenges that folks may have arrived with today, and just knowing that somebody sitting near them is praying for them can mean an awful lot to them. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for the life that you share with us. We thank you for your willingness to want to be our strength and our hope, for your willingness to want to share every moment of every day with us, to do in us what we could never do for ourselves, to do through us what we never thought was possible. Father, thank you for your sufficiency in the past year, and with great expectancy, we thank you for your sufficiency for the things that lie ahead in 2016. Father, we know that life carries both its burdens and its blessings. And we pray that we will not become content in our blessings, and that we will not be overwhelmed by our burdens. But Father, in both the blessings and the burdens, we will discover your perfect will. Father, we trust you with our needs. You have been more than gracious to meet the financial needs of New Hope. My prayer today is that you will also meet the needs of ministry through New Hope, the needs of ministry that require flesh and blood, mind and will and soul, body, teaching our kids, reaching out to our communities. You're sufficient, Father, not only for that which we need financially, but for sufficient for that which we need personally. We trust you for all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Anybody understand what that song we just sang was talking about? Yeah. Amen. 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 And if you don't, just wait a little bit, because you will. You will. Last week, we kicked off 2016. We talked about the less, more lifestyle. We're familiar with the less, more concept at the beginning of a new year because we're familiar with putting together resolutions or thoughts or proposals about our own life at that time. We talk about less debt, more savings, less weight, more shape, less clutter, more space. But I challenged you last week to look at that with a new framework in mind, and that is to look at it very simply. Less me, more Jesus. John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ, understood that when in probably his most classic words, John the Baptist said about his cousin, Jesus Christ, he said, I must decrease and he must increase. The Apostle Paul understood that even in a fresh way after he got saved on the road to Damascus and now had the indwelling presence of Christ in him and the person of the Holy Spirit, which, quite frankly, folks, don't ever let that scare you. That's what it simply means to be a Christian. God comes in the person of his Spirit to live within our human spirit. And when Paul had come to grips with all of what that meant for him, he summarized it in maybe one of his most memorized verses of his 13 books, with Galatians 2:20, when Paul said, I, Paul, am crucified with Christ. And that word crucified in the English, it sounds like it is a singular past tense. But in the language in which Paul was writing, It's an unusual kind of tense we don't have any equivalent for in our English language. It is a present progressive tense. And what Paul literally is saying, I am being crucified. He said it differently in another passage when he said, I die daily. This is a current, ongoing process until the day we go home to glory. I am crucified with Christ. Why, Paul? So that it's not I who lives and reign in my life, but it's Christ who lives and reigns in and through me. Less of me, more of Christ. We talked about ways in which this can become true for us in our spiritual life. We talked about less doubt, more trust. We talked about less worry, more rest. Less stuff, more ministry. And so with this little piece of paper, I ask you in the course of last Sunday's sermon to write down what God was directing you that you needed less and more of in your life. If you weren't here last week, take the opportunity to pray about that. Maybe through today's message or in the course of this week, you will fill out this. Isn't this a real fancy piece of paper? But what I'm asking you to do with this is to keep it. Fill it out, and maybe only fill out two lines, not all four. That's okay. But keep it. Keep it in your Bible. Put it in your wallet. I've put a thing on my calendar in the office so it reminds us when we get to the last two Sundays of the year, we're gonna come back and revisit these. Okay? And I shared with you last week that if we get to the end of this year and there's going to be less and more in our lifestyle, it's only going to be possible because we've been engaged in a process that involves four steps. Check on your memory. What's the first step in this process? Choice. We've got to choose. Just as Joshua said, choose you this day whom you will serve. It starts with a choice. It can't begin. The process will not begin till you choose. Just planning, just thinking about it, you must choose. Yes, this is what I want. The second step in the process is what? Consistency. We must choose every day. Just as Paul said, I'm crucified today, tomorrow, the next day, until he calls me home. You and I must be consistent with our choice of less of me and more of him. We must be consistent in prayer, listening to God. We must be consistent in Bible study, learning from God. We must be consistent in memorizing Scripture. All right, putting the Word of God in our heart. We must be consistent in our worship. Last week, that's when I talked about the 21 days of prayer and fasting. Okay, here's what I think I'm going to do for my 21 days. I'm doing it because I hate it. Okay? I hate this more than not eating. I'm going to journal for 21 days. That's weird because people preach about all the time how you ought to journal. I hate journaling, okay? And here's what I'm going to do at the end of 21 days. I'm going to burn what I journaled. Okay? I cannot tell you over the years as a pastor the hurt I've had to deal with when somebody journals stuff and left it and now their relatives read it. Because sometimes what you journal is not meant for somebody else's eyes. So burn it, okay? Don't hold on to it. Unless you're going to publish it, burn it, okay? But I'm going to journal for the next 21 days because that is a very hard... I love to write, but journaling is about me. What God is doing right now in me that day. And I don't like to do that. What's the last? Excuse me, third step in the process. How do we maintain? Accountability. We must be accountable. Tell somebody that will hold you accountable. This is the choices you've made, less of, more of. And number four, the word I really wowed everybody with last week, it just got you so excited. Contemplation. It's a lost art in the 21st century. Contemplation is the slow, thoughtful, savoring reading of Bible verses. We said that the way we're going to do that together as a church family, the way we're going to make the choice, the way we want to try to maintain consistency, to hold each other accountable, and to develop this process of contemplation in our lives is we're going to do it out of the book of Psalms. Probably the best book out of all the Bible to deal with the subject of contemplation. Now, to whet your appetite a little bit, just in case you weren't here, what were some unusual facts that we learned about the book of Psalm last week? Do you remember? Yeah, it's the middle chapter of the Bible is found in the book of Psalms. Now, before we get to that one, what's the longest chapter of the Bible? Psalm 119. What's the shortest chapter of the Bible? Psalm 117. What do you think might be the center chapter of the Bible? 118. Very good. How many chapters are there before Psalm 118? 594. Good. Now that you know that answer, how many are after Psalm 118? Yeah, that one's pretty good. Yeah. John Longstaff's the one who said the same amount as before, all right? He had no idea, but it was a pretty smart answer. And so if you take 594 and add 594, what do you come up with? 1188. What do you think the center verse in the Bible is? Psalm 118:8, and this is a verse you can center your life on. Do not trust in man, but put your trust in God. So if your life ever gets off center, go right back to the core of the Bible. So we're going to study this book that we find in the very heart of the Scriptures as we continue to investigate, inquire, and engage in a less, more lifestyle. So turn to Psalm chapter 1. All right, that's where we'll be today. Just as a heads up, next week we'll be in Psalm 5. You don't have to ignore chapters 2, 3, and 4. You can read them on your way to chapter 5, but next Sunday's sermon will be in chapter 5. There was a young man who was learning how to become a paratrooper. Before his first jump, he was given these four instructions. Jump when you were told. Count to 10 and pull the ripcord. In the unlikely event that your chute doesn't open, pull the emergency ripcord. Number four, when you get down, a truck will be there to take you back to the airfield. The young soldier memorized those four bits of instructions, climbed aboard the plane. The plane climbed to 10,000 feet and the paratroopers began to jump. When the young soldier was told to jump, he jumped. He then counted to 10. He pulled the ripcord. Nothing happened. His chute failed to open. He pulled the emergency ripcord. Nothing happened. It failed to open. Oh, great, he thought. And I suppose the truck won't be there when I get down there either. I don't know if you've ever had days like that, you've ever had moments like that where failures, disappointments have hit you so hard that you don't think everything will be right in your world again. Sometimes the whole world seems to be against us. You will discover that attitude again and again and again throughout the book of Psalms. Many of the Psalms are kind of called, they're also lamentations because life has been tough. But in the organization of the book of Psalms, somebody had great wisdom that comes from God to give us a good foundation as we start this study. Because in Psalm chapter 1, it gives us direction on how our life should be structured so that we don't feel like life is always against us. What I learned in a far more significant way in 2015 than I had ever known before is the idea that time is exceedingly precious. I learned that in a couple of different ways. I learned that time was precious because we never know when those that we love are going to move away from us. I learned that time was precious in my two dark nights of the soul when I wasn't sure I was going to see the sun rise again. At the outset of 2016, I've learned that time is precious when I got that first picture of a freshly born grandchild. Time is precious. Tomorrow I'll be doing a memorial service for a woman who lived to be 102. Yesterday I did a service for a man who made it to 97. Today at Garfield, they're honoring a life that lived 9 years. And whether it's 9 or 97 or 102, in the context of eternity, all of those are very, very short. Is anybody else a little warm in here? We turn the heater off, if you would, please. I'm burning up. You see, we can make the most of the time we have left on earth by making the most of our walk with Christ. We often live, even as Christians, somewhat carelessly, not giving as much thought as we could about our relationship with God. And one day, we will all have to stand before the Creator of the universe. And the question that demands an answer is this: will God be our Heavenly Father, who will receive us into His arms as a child? Or will this God be our judge, who will direct us to eternal punishment? To make the most of our walk with God, it is essential that we have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ as our Savior and our Lord. Apart from Christ, there is no walk with God. You do not have a walk with God just because you were born in the United States of America. You do not have a walk with God just because your parents and your grandparents were Christians. You do not have a walk with God just because you're a good man or you're a good woman. I had an agnostic tell me the other day, "Well, surely if there is a heaven, my mother made it." I'm an agnostic, and surely if there is a heaven, my mother made it. I don't know about you, but I would have wanted to have hedged my bet a little bit more than that. You only get heaven if you have Jesus. I can't make it any simpler than that. Tim, I am better than over half the people on this world, so surely I'm going to make it. Or Tim, I'm not as bad as, whoa, man, I'm not that bad. It's not based on you comparing you to anybody else. It's based on the comparison of you to Jesus. Me to Jesus. And Jesus said, "I don't want you to be caught short. I'm here for you. Have a relationship with me." If you've never done that, Tim, I've been coming to New Hope for 2 years. Great. God bless you. You like our pews. They're comfortable. Wonderful. It can't be because the pastor is tall, dark, and handsome. Coming to New Hope, coming to any church. My grandfather used to say, going to church won't make you a Christian any more than living in a garage will make you a car. It just won't happen. You only become a Christian if willfully you say, "I'm a sinner." Not a mistaker. I'm a sinner. And I believe that Jesus wants to be my Savior. I invite Him into my life. It's not any more complicated than that. To the child of God, to most of us who are here and we have a relationship with Christ, we need to make the most of our walk with Christ. We need to not be careless Christians who just live day by day. Okay, I got my fire insurance. When I die, I'm going to heaven. But you know, I'm just going to get by in life any old way I want to. We need to be challenged about this deeper walk with Christ. Don't settle for the "I know nothing." Where'd that come from? Yeah, Hogan's Heroes. All right. Yeah, all of you under 50 didn't have a clue to what that one was. Go to the old channel, black and white programs. All right, go watch Hogan's Heroes. "I know nothing. I feel nothing. I want nothing. I desire nothing." Let's really think this less, more lifestyle through. In Psalm chapter 1, we have a plea for a deeper, more solid, more productive walk with God. The person who has this growing relationship with God, he's called blessed. This term blessed is very expressive. It's plural. It's much like the word crucified in the book of Galatians, except this is in Hebrew. It's a plural form, and we could translate it, "Oh, the happiness many times over. Oh, the happiness again and again and again that is mine." How are we so happy again and again and again? Let's read the passage. "Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, and blessed is the man who does not stand in the way of sinners, and blessed is the man or woman who doesn't sit in the seat of mockers or scorners." The man who is blessed is the one who puts his delight in the law of the Lord. And on this law, he meditates day and night. Contemplation, guys. Contemplation. He is like a tree. She is like a tree that is planted by streams of water, which will yield its fruit in season. The leaf does not wither, and whatever they do prospers. This is not so with the wicked, the ones who are not blessed. Not so with them. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in judgment, nor sinners will they sit in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over, the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked, can you say those last two words? Will perish. So how do we make the most of our walk with Christ? How can we have blessed walk the psalmist is talking about? We need to look carefully in three directions, and we answer three important questions. First off, let's look around. How are we being influenced? What is that that shapes and molds and influences my life? There's only two possible ways to be influenced. Either we are influenced with that which is godly and righteous, or that which is ungodly and unholy. We need to look around and ask ourselves the question, what is shaping us? Let's look at the ungodly influence according to Psalm chapter 1 first. Do you have to teach kids how to be bad? Bo is so cute and innocent, but guess what's in him? Sin. That is my grandson, and guess what? He was born a sinner just like his father. And you know why his father was born a sinner? Because his father was a sinner. We cannot give to the next generation what we do not have. Perfection. Do you have to teach a kid how to say no? No. They will learn how to say no probably faster than yes. Do you have to teach a kid how to look around the corner? If anybody's in the room, going to catch them at whatever it is they're doing? Why does a little kid reach for a pretty thing on a counter and turn to look? They learn it very fast. It's in their nature. We were by nature sinners. Thank God that in Christ He has come to rescue us, to make us no longer sinners, but now adopt us as children of God. Yet we must beware of ungodly influences in our life, because ungodly influence gets worse and worse. Notice the progressive stages of ungodliness in this passage. It starts out with this: walking in the counsel of the ungodly. This term walk speaks of direction. Turn from ungodly counsel. Walk away from it. Don't go in the direction of wicked counsel. There are some folks, and guys, I've never done a survey on this, but I just hear conversations, all right? There are some folks who wouldn't think of starting their day without reading the horoscope. It does not come from God. Oh, Tim, I do it just for fun. But how often do you go back and think, wow, that came true today? The longer you do it, the more faith that you'll put in it. Don't go that direction. That's the count. It's not wise. Some people will consult psychics that they hear on TV or the radio. Some folks will listen to a talk show and get counsel on how to deal with everyday life. I am convinced that until social media arrived, one of the most significant influences shaping the thought process of our culture in America are talk show hosts. That's scary. Why? Because they have the same circuit of people on again and again and again, and that which we once knew was wrong, now we've seen it so often, it must be okay. Well, it must be right. That's the way of the wicked. When we go in the direction of worldly wisdom and we forsake godly wisdom, we are under godly influences. And you know what the next step is? The psalmist tells us, we walk in the way of the wicked. Next, we will now stand in the way of sinners. After we go in the direction of seeking advice from that which is ungodly, we will move to consulting the ungodly, to now identifying with them. We're not opposing their viewpoint, we're embracing. Fight the good fight. We are not opposing their viewpoint. We are embracing now what they say in agreement. At first, we walk to listen. Now we don't walk back to where we should be. We stand where they stand. We identify with their position. We fellowship in their lifestyle. There's only one position, folks, that is worth having, and that is God's position. There's only one viewpoint that is going to be holy, and that is God's viewpoint. Notice the progression. We walk in their direction. Now we stand in their perspective. Now we're going to progress to sitting in the seat of the scornful. We're going to start now hanging out. We identify with them so much that we just kick back in the living room with them. Sitting speaks of a resting place. We've landed on a position that we are now comfortable with. We first just walked around some godly, ungodly counsel. Then we began to stand around ungodly influence. Finally, we adopted for our very own. And the Bible says that this means we are now sitting in the seat of the scorners and the scoffers. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever been around folks who said, "I don't believe in God"? Did you ever respond kindly, lovingly, and say, "Oh, I'm so sorry, I believe in God"? You ever heard anybody say, you know, a bunch of hypocrites in church? They're right. There are. But there's also hypocrites in the restaurant and GB3s. Okay? Pick a place. They're there. We use those as excuses, but then all of a sudden we become scoffers. Think about moral issues in society today. How about sleeping around outside of marriage? How about sleeping around inside of marriage? Nobody said amen. You see, we get comfortable because it's become so prevalent in our society. We now have become those who sit in the seat of scorners. We now embrace not the fruit of the Spirit, but that which is unholy, and we scoff and we mock at that which is holy and godly, the seat of the scorner. Very impressive, but it's located right next to the gate of hell. We should be a bit more selective about the influencers in our life. Let's look at godly influence. The blessed man, verse 2. The person who makes much of a walk with God will surround themselves with an influence that is healthy. And how do we do this? It tells us two ways. Number one, we delight in the Word of God. How do you come to delight in God's Word? It is because there was a time when we found delight in Jesus Christ. Peter said in his first letter, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 2 and 3, these words, like a newborn baby, like Bo, craves milk. Mother's milk. Just like a newborn baby, we crave the sincere milk of the Word, that we may grow up in our salvation now that we have tasted that the Lord is good. Our appetite for the Lord and His Word will become dull when we have tasted too much of the world. Do you realize there's only one letter difference between Word and world? Just one letter. And the sad thing is, we often can't tell the difference between what the influence of the world is versus the influence of God. In our minds, they seem so similar, and yet they are so very, very different. The second thing he says in this passage is we meditate on God's Word. Not only delight in it, but contemplate, slow, thought-provoking, thinking about God's Word. It's not enough just to read the words. There must be passages that we allow to shape our thoughts. We memorize them. Like Romans 12, 2, do not be conformed to this world, W-O-R-L-D, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. How? By the Word, W-O-R-D, that we may prove what is good, acceptable, and the perfect will of God. This is more than just casually reading through the Bible. These are truths that are designed to be internalized. There are some verses that must be memorized, so familiar with us that wherever we are, God can plant those in our thought process and we can grow and be influenced by them. This requires consistency and contemplation. How can we stay clean while in a world that influences us in the wrong way? The scripture says, meditate, meditate. Psalm 119:9 says, where shall a young man cleanse his ways? By taking heed to God's word. John 15:3, Jesus says, now you are clean through the word which I have spoken to you. And Jesus prayed in John 17:17, Father, sanctify them, my disciples, through the truth. Your word is truth. We can make the most of our walk with God by making the most of His word in our lives. So we look around, that's one direction we look, and we ask the question, how are you being influenced? Verses 3 and 4 challenge us to look inside. Who are we becoming? Nobody else can answer that question but you and God. We can con each other, but you and God can answer the question, who are you becoming inside based on that which is influencing you most from the outside, the word or the world? Look inside your heart. The person who delights in God's word, he or she meditates, contemplates on God's word. The scripture says when we do that, we will become like a tree that is planted by the rivers of water. We have found the source of true blessedness and happiness. We are refreshed and we are nourished, and it shows. And it will show in our life, according to this passage, in three ways. It tells us that we will be fruitful. The scripture says we will bring forth fruit in season. We will be fruitful people. What is a fruitful person? I could suggest a couple of observations. One, a fruitful person is somebody who it's evident in their life, the love of Christ, the joy of Christ, the peace of Christ, the gentleness of Christ, the kindness of Christ, the fruit of the Spirit. Obvious fruit should be seen in us in growing measure. We ought to get bigger crops every year that we walk in the Word. I would suggest to you, fruit is family members and friends, neighbors, co-workers coming to discover Jesus Christ because you have allowed God to speak through your lips the word of truth to them. John Piper, a pastor and author, describes a fruitful life like this. He said, they are the people whose lives are refreshing and nourishing to be around. You go away from their presence fed. You go away strengthened. You go away with a taste for spiritual things that are awakened. Their words are healing, convicting, encouraging, deepening, and enlightening. Be around them is like a meal. But the passage also says, not only will we bear fruit, but we will be durable. Durable. Their leaf will not wither. Your leaf, in other words, it won't fade and die. It won't fall off the tree. Hot winds can blow. Tough times can happen. The rain doesn't fall. You can experience dryness in your life. This person is planted, though, by the rivers of living water. That is Christ Himself. We are planted in God's Word, and while other people are withering away, we remain nourished, strong, and vibrant in our faith. Regardless of which way the wind blows, if we are planted in the Word, we will find delight because we meditate on the Word day and night. We are durable. Brenda Watson, who will probably be in the next service on about the fourth row on my right. Brenda Watson sent me a text last evening. She said, Tim, I'm so excited that we're going to do the Psalms this year. She said, I'm so excited. I've been reading the Psalms all week. And she said, I found a parallel verse later in the Psalms that goes with Psalm chapter 1. She said, it's Psalm 92:14. And in Psalm 92:14, it says this, they will still bear fruit, just like this tree, okay, planted by the river of water. But there's an added couple of words in the 92nd Psalm. It says, they will still bear fruit in old age. Doesn't that make some of you feel really good? Your fruit-bearing days are not over. Your child-bearing days may be behind you, but your fruit-bearing days are still ahead of you. They will stay fresh and green. You don't have to become old and stale. The psalmist says, in your old age, you can stay fresh and green. And here's how Brenda Watson phrased it. She said, I love the idea that even though I age in Christ, I'm full of sap. You want to be full of sap that comes from God's word? Or do you want to be full of, you fill in the blank, that comes from the world? It is your choice. Number three, we will be prosperous. Fruitful, durable, and whatever they do shall prosper. Does that mean if you delight in God's word and meditate on his words, you will be like a tree and you will prosper? Absolutely, yes, it does. Some of you are saying, oh, Tim, what about Psalm 34:19? Good, glad you've read it. It says that many are the afflictions of the righteous. Tim, how about Psalm 73, verse 3? For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Or how about verse 12 in that same chapter? Behold, these are ungodly. They prosper in the world and they increase in riches. You see, according to some of these verses, it looks like the wicked are the ones who are filthy rich. The good person is the one who suffers. But folks, keep reading. Verse 17 in Psalm 73 says, that's what I thought until I went into the sanctuary of God, and then I understood their end. God gave the writer some insight. If you haven't seen the end, don't overstate the proposition. Psalm 1:4 says, the ungodly will perish. If you don't remember anything else from today, here's a one sentence to hold on to. In this world, for the believer, this is the only hell we will ever see and experience. For the unbeliever, this is the only heaven they will ever know. The ungodly are not so prosperous in the end. And number three, third direction we look ahead. How will you be judged? There's a destiny that we will all be a part of. Up ahead, judgment day is coming. Will you be judged among the ungodly? For they will not be able to stand on the day of judgment. The ungodly will not stand. They don't have a leg to stand on. They don't have an excuse that will hold them up. They've made all the excuses about why they can't go to church, about why they can't be saved today. Excuses. But on that day, they will not be able to sit on their excuse anymore. They won't be able to stand on their own self-righteousness. They won't be able to stand and look God in the eye. In heaven, the scripture says, there'll only be one congregation, and it's the congregation of the righteous. No sinners in the assembly. Jesus will separate, he used his own words, the sheep from the goats. There'll be one pure, holy, godly congregation, and they are the congregation of the redeemed, those who accepted the Christ who paid their debt, the debt we can never pay on our own. It is a holy congregation. If I wasn't in that congregation, I would do business with God right now. I would not wait another second. If I read that verse just now and you can't say with full assurity, hey, I know I'm in that congregation, then I would repent and ask Jesus in my life at this very moment. You don't need to come forward. You don't need to raise your hand. You need to humble your heart and say, Lord Jesus, come into my life. The Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall perish. God knows his own. It's the way of the cross. It's the way of repentance and faith. Have their own way. It's the way of I'll do as I please. It's the way of the world. It's the way of self-righteousness. It's the way of works. I certainly have done more good deeds than I've done bad. It's the way of man-made religion. Or maybe you're the one who says, you know, God's a God of love and he wouldn't send me to hell. And you're absolutely right, he wouldn't. Because you know the way all by yourself. You don't need any help getting there. You've chosen it yourself. Make the most of your walk with God. It begins with right influences. Godly influence will result in who we become on the inside. Godly character. Godly character is what God is looking for. Let me wrap this up. There's a certain courthouse in Ohio that stands in a very unique location. Raindrops that fall on the north side of the building go into the Lake of Ontario and on out into the Gulf of St. Lawrence. While those falling on the south side go into the Mississippi River and end up in the Gulf of Mexico. At precisely the point of the peak of the roof, just a gentle puff of wind can determine the destiny of many raindrops. It'll make a difference of more than 2,000 miles as to their final destination. Spiritual application is pretty clear, isn't it? By the smallest choice of words, by the smallest choice of lifestyle, we set in motion influences that can change the course of others' lives here and now and could determine and impact their eternal destiny. By what neighborhood we walk, sit, and stand in. The central lesson in Psalm 1 is this. There is not the slightest similarity between the spiritually accelerating life of the righteous and the slowly eroding life of the wicked. Take time to ponder the contrasts and take time to consider where you're walking. The godly, happiness many times over, not so with the ungodly. Uncompromised purity with the godly, driven by the wind to and fro for the ungodly. Has a guide, and the Word of God has no guide at all. We are rooted like a tree, we're like chaff blown by the wind. We stand tall in the presence of God's judgment, we are unable to stand in God's presence. We're a special object of God's care, we have no rights to be in His family. Our destiny is secure, safe, and prosperous. We perish. Our Daily Bread says it this way: sow a thought, reap an act. Sow an act, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap character. Sow a character, reap a destiny. There's a headstone in England that says this: pause, my friend, as you walk by. As you are now, so once was I. As I am now, so you will be. Prepare, my friend, to follow me. A visitor stopped and read that one day, and he wrote a response. And he took a rock and he put it underneath the headstone with his own words written to it. And here's what he added: to follow you is not my intent until I know which way you went. See, destiny is determined not by chances, but by choices. What choice have you made? If you want to read a positive side of sit, walk, and stand, Psalm 1 is the negative side. Don't walk with sinners. Don't stand with sinners. Don't sit with scoffers. If you want to do a little more work on your own this week, go read the book of Ephesians. In the book of Ephesians, Paul tells the believer where to walk, where to sit, where to stand. Be good to read. Good to read. Let's pray. Our Father, these are your words, not mine. This is your intent and purpose, not ours. The desire of your heart, Father, is that by listening and learning from your word, we can be men and women that are most blessed. Blessed with joy, blessed with peace, blessed with security, blessed with comfort. May we be like a tree planted in the waters of your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, for that man or woman that maybe in the middle of this service said, Lord Jesus, what the psalmist wrote was all about me, and I've been walking in the counsel of the ungodly. I want to change direction. Thank you for hearing their prayer, giving them life, hope everlasting. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.